All right, 33 points lower on the Nifty is what we have. 12,953 is where we stand at right now. So, I mean, things are looking a little down and out. Bank Nifty is down about 1/3%. And I mean, across the board, I think there is a little bit of profit taking, which is evident. Broader market, absolutely no trouble at all. I mean, actually, let me just quickly look at what is the Nifty mid-cap and the small-cap indices doing. The mid-cap index is up 2%. So I think that's the reason why the market breadth is so positive. And let me just also quickly put out what the small-cap index is doing. That is up 1.7%. So 1.8, 1.7 on the mid-cap and the small-cap part of the market. And market breadth is extremely, extremely strong. Okay, let's now focus on a sector which has done very, very well. Steel space. Stocks zoomed yesterday, anything between 5 and 7%. And the rally has been so sharp that it is now starting to lift up laggards, absolute laggards like Steel Authority of India, for example. Tata Steel, JSPL, JSW Steel, of course, have been doing well, but now it's starting to spread. What are stocks pricing in? That's the question. We have Amit Dixit of Edelweiss Institutional Equities joining in, Bhavesh Chauhan of IDBI Capital joining in on the show as well in just a bit. Amit, it's a pleasure. Thanks very much for joining us. Amit, first of all, is the rally that we are seeing, it's seasonally, the seasonality aspect aside, are there some specific triggers which is leading to the price strength we are seeing and consequently, the strength in stocks? One reason I heard is basically, shipping logistics being extremely tight. I mean, unavailability of large ships to sort of ferry material from one place, from producing countries or processing countries to consuming countries. Any thoughts on that, and what according to you is the number one reason?
I would classify it as an unseasonal strength, because typically if you see the Q4 of any calendar year or Q3 of our year is seasonally weak because of destocking that happens everywhere. But now what we have seen, the demand side response to pandemic has been very well documented, very well researched, but I believe supply side has been equally ignored. So if you look at the blast furnaces, for example, closed in Europe or even US, now they are slowly resuming production, but demand uptake, particularly in auto, has taken everybody by surprise. So if you look at the lead times of material in Europe and US, it's like almost Q2 of next year. Not even Q1, by the way. So that's the reason why, that there is a shortage of steel, something that we have never heard before. Even on domestic front, the prices have largely tracked the international prices, therefore, and you see no respite. So HRC is already at around 46,500 on an average, and I won't be surprised if it hits the new high. And that is the optimism is driving the stocks on the revenue side. On cost side, as far as the Indian stock are concerned, coking coal appears to be, very, very salubrious. And therefore, the margins of players, that I have mentioned in your show before, and I will repeat it at the cost of being a little bit abstract, that if Q2 was sort of, a very good quarter, Q3 is going to be absolutely blockbuster.
Blockbuster, okay, that's really saying it as you're seeing it, Amit. Interesting. So, I mean, this is that time where I guess you're saying that demand is really picking up and, raw material input prices aren't as big a concern. Tell us a bit about spreads. I mean, I was reading somewhere in one of the reports that spreads are up to almost a three-year high now. How much higher? So, can you define that blockbuster in terms of some ranges or numbers?
Well, I would like to see spreads. When you talk about raw material spread, if you look at adjusted spread, that is adjusted for coking coal prices, they are at record high. It's not 3-year high or 5-year high. It's the record high ever in the history. Now, if you look at the margins, for example, EBITDA per ton, easily, I believe, going by the average increase, whatever we have seen until November, Tata Steel can easily do, for example, 17,000 rupees per ton. And sale can easily do 8,000. So these are the kind of margins we are talking about. And if the price hike that they have taken in November and that we are hearing from our channel checks sustains in December, you can see even higher margins. So these are the sort of numbers that we are talking about. Mind you, all these companies, Tata Steel, for instance, in Q1, EBITDA per ton for domestic operations was around 5,000. And we are talking about a shift from 5,000 to roughly touching 18, 19,000. So this is the sort of, you know, difference that we have seen in maybe 6 months or so.
Right. Just to that point, Amit, on lead times that you mentioned, Bhavesh Chauhan of IDBI is also with us. Amit, the lead time, what is the lead time you said now for steel products?
You're asking me about lead time?
Yes.
Yeah, so I was mentioning the lead time that actually mills are taking to supply to their end customers in Europe and US. So if you look at in Europe, for example, prices are rising, have been rising. And we pointed it out in our note in July, as early as July, when we said that the spreads in Europe are going to improve. But this kind of improvement even we had not factored in our numbers. So when I say that, you know, lead time, you know, the producers don't have steel because blast furnaces have not resumed full operations. And the uptick in auto demand, courtesy the stimulus that we have seen in Europe, uptick in some of the downstream sectors, such as construction, such as your service center demand, has simply, you know, taken people by surprise. And what happens that in the phase where destocking should have happened, actually we are seeing restocking. People are scrambling to get supplies and they're not able to get. So this is the sort of lead time. And the lead time is, you know, people are in US, I hear that the lead time is like almost you will get steel only in February, in Europe in March. So this is the sort of, you know, difference that we see compared to previous years.
Okay, we'll come to stocks and valuations, etc. Is shipping also a bit of an issue, Amit, along with everything else?
Yeah, shipping is also a little bit of issue, but frankly, I have not heard a lot on that. I would concentrate more on lead times. So shipping, I also reckon, is an issue over here.
Bhavesh, you're sort of joining in a little bit late, but what are your thoughts in terms of the rally we've seen, and basically what are these stocks pricing in? Amit was saying that HRC prices can hit all-time highs. You know, EBITDA per ton for steel companies will continue to improve. If Q2 was good, Q3 will be blockbuster. His words, not mine. What are your thoughts? Bhavesh? Okay, I think we lost that line. Amit, so let me just come back to you. What are stocks now sort of pricing in terms of valuations?
See, some of these stocks, I would say, see, in such kind of market, first of all, valuation takes a little bit of backseat. I'm not saying that we should not be cognizant of that, because ultimately things revert. There's a mean reversion in the market and these stocks. Coming to stocks, I would like to say that, for example, Tata Steel, still people are very optimistic about the deal with the supposed deal with SSAB going through, and there are all sorts of numbers that are floating around. So therefore, while you're if you take the average, well, these stocks, I think valuation-wise, you would find that stocks are at their right valuation, and there is no case for a valuation upgrade. However, in times like these, when you know you have got expectations of better earnings and the fact that volumes are also doing good, well, valuations tend to take a little bit of backseat in the short term. But I would be very, very cognizant. I would, in fact, be very discerning as far as stocks are concerned. So Tata Steel, for example, for us, is the preferred pick. But JSW, for instance, we believe that the valuation has peaked out. SAIL, an interesting name again, and we would see that SAIL would be a stock that will that is due for better days. In fact, if you look at any steel rally, SAIL is the one that is actually laggard, and that is what is going up now. Because the operating leverage factor in SAIL is probably the highest among its peers. So I would say valuation-wise, yeah, there is not much of a comfort. But in this kind of euphoria, well, valuation takes a little bit of a backseat.
Yeah, Amit, get that. I mean, that's the kind of market we're in, which is why I'm going to come back to the numbers that you gave earlier. I mean, I think I was missing some audio, plus the numbers were so eye-popping. Did you say that in terms of the margin expansion, EBITDA per ton could move from some 8,000 to double digits for Tata Steel? So, I mean, it ties in with the point you just made. If this is a momentum market and valuations will take a back seat, then let's try to see which company is going to give the highest growth and the highest margin expansion. So which would that company be? And if you could repeat the number as well.
No, so I mentioned that SAIL, for instance, you can see Q3 EBITDA at 8,000, up from 4,200 odd what they did in Q2. Tata Steel, for example, in Q1 they did EBITDA per ton of around 5,000, Q2 they did 12,000, and Q3 they can easily do upwards of 17,000-18,000 if the present price hike sustains, and if we see the price hike that they have been mentioning in December going through. So these are the sort of numbers that we are likely to see.
Alright, this is literally an upcycle, and for now it seems the bulls want to ride it for good reason. Amit, thank you very much for joining in and explaining all the dynamics to us. And there you have it, explains the kind of move that we've seen, metals being the lead sector obviously of the rally overall in the month of November. Let's take a quick break on that note. Lots more coming up on the other side.